conferences. But after the recent heavy rains and flooding, we hear more instances of snakes entering the houses in urban areas also. Very thoughtful of the scientific committee to have introduced this topic. And we have Dr. Gopal Subramanian with us to discuss the rational management of snake bites. Over to Dr. Gopal Subramanian.
Thank you, Dr. Rigdish, sir. Respected seniors, my friends, it gives me an immense pleasure to be here in Puduvai Pedicon, because this is the first place I learned the initial lessons of pediatrics, Jugmar. So I thank my teachers, Professor Srinivasan sir, Professor Nalini madam, Vishnu Bhatt sir, and Mahadevan sir, for making me what I am today. So the topic for today's discussion is rational management of snake bite envenomation in children. The next 20 minutes or so, we'll discuss how the snake bite envenomation in children differs from an adult one. The first session of a conference is like a first session of a test match. As great Sunil Gavaskar says, so how you play the first session brings out how the test match goes. So I thank the organizing committee for asking me to bat in the first session. Hope I can play to the gallery. So I bring greetings from Triveni Sangamam. So Pambai Kandal, Padayin Nadangu Vandu Solvaru. And I am Talayana Pata, Ippadai Thorkin, Ippadai Vendum. Is that your view? So the next 10 minutes we'll discuss without any idioms and jargons the simple presentation of the snake bite envenomation and its treatment. As you all know, snake bite is an acute, life-threatening, time-limiting medical emergency. It's a preventable public health hazard, often faced by rural population. It's not an uncommon issue because it depends upon the geographical area. It is quite common in some of the places like ours, where I come from. We get a lot of cases of snake bite now in hospital. WHO estimates almost 15,000 people out of 2 lakh bitten by snakes die every year in India. So quite a big number. So pediatric snake bite mortality and morbidity contribute significantly to national statistics. It accounts for 3% of deaths. That's a huge chunk. Children often present the severe effects of snake bite owing to their lower volume distribution related to the mass of injected venom. The doses of anti-venom used in children are same as adults because the volume of venom does not depend on the size of the liquid. There are more than 2,000 species of snakes in the world. And of the 300 species which are there in India, only 1/6 are venomous. The commonest types of snake bite is from resident viper, followed by the cobra, crate, and cat snake, and so on. So coming to the snakes and their toxicity. We have Elapidae, Viperidae, and Hydrophidae. Elapidae is neurotoxic, mainly Indian cobra, king cobra, crates, and sea snakes. Viperidae is vasculotoxic, the pitless vipers and pit vipers. The Hydrophidae are the sea snakes. All of them are poisonous and they are myotoxic. Luckily, only 1/6 are poisonous. The rest do not have any venom storage lumens or any kind of anatypical venom delivery apparatus. Snake venoms contain more than 20 different constituents which are responsible for the envenomation, including proteases, thrombin-like enzymes, phospholipases. The Elapidae venom work in the presynaptic or postsynaptic junctions. It causes chirale-like paralysis. The Viperidae has procoagulant enzymes, hemorrhages, hyaluronidase, which results in the formation of, inhibit the formation of fibrin, resulting DOC, consumption coagulopathy, local tissue damage, and spread of the venom through the connective tissue. The Hydrophidae toxin causes rhabdomyolysis and myoglobinuria. The clinical presentation depends on the species of snake, amount of venom injected, season of the bite, whether the snake is fed or unfed, dry or a complete bite, venom injected directly into the vessel or not. The local effects include progressive lymph swelling, blistering, discoloration, undue bleeding or oozing, and severe excruciating pain. Non-specific features include headache, nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, and collapse. The specific symptoms, which are vasculotoxic from the viper bite, This is the local pain and local bleeding, bruising, dental enlargement, blistering, local infection, abscess formation, and so on. The coagulopathy, as I said, results in bleeding to the mucosal surfaces, and renal toxicity may result in acute kidney injury. Neurotoxicity usually results in blurred vision, diplopia, ptosis, dysarthria. This can be easily remembered as 5D and 2P. As I put, ptosis, diplopia, dysarthria, these are all very common in LRPD poisoning. And myotoxicity results in severe rhabdomyolysis, muscle stiffness, myalgia, myoglobinuria, and paralysis. Non-venom related symptoms include palpitation, sweating, tachycardia, tachypnea, hypo or hypertension, cold extremities, shock, may have dilated pupils, which are suggestive of sympathetic overactivity. A word of mention about the dry bite, almost 50% of bites by pit vipers and rustle vipers, and almost 5 to 10% bites by the cobras are dry bites because no venom is injected during these bites. High index of suspicion should always be maintained. If a child becomes unconscious in an unsupervised outside area of the child is playing or not, include puncture marks, which may be very, very difficult to see in a child, but we have to examine if a child is brought with unconsciousness. We have to see for puncture marks. Sorry. Bleeding may or may not be there. Regional tender lymphadenopathy may be present. So management depends on these lines. The first aid management, which is given in the site of this thing, and immediate clinical management, ICU management, laboratory evidence of envenomation, monitoring the patient, anti-snake venom, and supportive treatment. This is a flowchart which clearly shows the how you manage a snake bite. Whether we have to see whether it's a non-venomous or venomous. If it's venomous, if it's symptomatic or dry bite, symptoms, as I've already mentioned, we can easily find out from the symptoms whether it's viper or elapid, this thing, viper or cobra bite and craig bite, so on, myotoxic. The final treatment is ASD. Do it right. Reassure the patient, immobilize the patient, get to the hospital immediately, tell the doctor about any symptoms like ptosis, dark urine, etc. Don't wash the wound with any antiseptics. Incision, suction, electrical shock should be avoided. Tourniquet is not recommended nowadays because it causes severe tissue damage and ischemic damage. Pressure immobilization technique has been advised as a reliable method. This pressure immobilization method is quite common with the fractures. How you do a splinting during a fracture, we have to do in the same way. Rapid clinical assessment and resuscitation should be done in the hospital. May have to give oxygen, IV access, airway breathing and circulation as in any emergency. We have to assess the level of consciousness. CPR may be needed. And history of the circumstance of bite and progression of local and system symptoms, signs are very important. The site of the bite and time of the bite, snake identification is quite important, whether to know it is venomous or non-venomous. ICU management, we may have to intubate and commence positive pressure ventilation. Circulatory failure may require isotonic fluids and pressure. Observe closely for progression of muscle weakness. Monitor the urine output. Assess respiratory function. Avoid unnecessary venipuncture. Puncture. A simple but yet effective method to find out whether it's a venomous or non-venomous bite is by this 20-minute whole blood clotting test. Place a few ml of freshly collected venous sample in a glass bottle. Leave it as such for 20 minutes. See whether it's coagulates or not. If it's not coagulating, definitely there is construction coagulopathy. Platelet may be decreased in viper bites. There may be leukocytosis. Blood film may show fragmented RBCs. Plasma and serum may be pink or brownish because of the gross hemoglobinuria, hemoglobinemia, and myoglobinemia. The SGOT, SGPT, CPK may be elevated. Bilirubin may be elevated because of the massive extravasation of blood. We have to see whether there is increase in creatinine or BUN levels as in renal failure. Urine examination for blood or myoglobin, microscopy for erythrocytes, red cell cast, massive proteinuria is a definite sign of viper poisoning. Monitor the patient, all the system needs to be monitored. Cardiovascular, respiratory, and neurological status needs to be monitored in, as with any other emergency. Laboratory investigations, we have to PTT, fibrinogen, D-dimer, all these levels needs to be continuously monitored. Local site assessment for infection, swelling, and tissue necrosis. Early surgical involvement is necessary if you suspect a compartment syndrome. So the mainstay of treatment is antivenom treatment. The antivenom is an immunoglobulin which has purified from serum or plasma of horse or sheep that has been immunized with venoms of more or one or more species of snake. We have polyvalent and monovalent anti-snake venom. What we usually use is the polyvalent one, which is produced from the Haskin Institute and Serum Institute of India. 1 cc of ASP neutralizes usually 0.6 milligram of cobra and viper venom, 0.45 milligram of soft-tailed viper venom and crape venom. The cost of one vial of ASP is almost 625 rupees. It has been considered as an emergency drug. It should be available in almost all hospitals. Indications for antivenom, if you suspect there is an venom agent, don't wait, start on with ASP. There is no absolute contraindication for antivenom treatment. So it has to be given as intravenous infusion, either as a lyophilized form or a liquid form. You have to dilute with 5 to 10 ml per kg of isotonic fluid. Dose of antivenom, as I said, is same as adult because the volume of venom injected does not depend on the size of the victim. Adrenaline should be always available. Almost 10% of children with where we use antivenom may result in anaphylaxis, so we need to have adrenaline with us. Local administration of antivenom at the site of bite is not recommended. Although IM route may seem rational, it should not be used as it is extremely painful, may increase the compartment pressure, and has not been shown to be effective. Dose of ASP, start with 10 vials. If there is over 1 hour, if there is no improvement, second dose may be repeated. If coagulation abnormality is present, we may have to give FFP, cryoprecipitate, press blood, and so on. Observation of response of antivenom. Immediate, there is decrease in nausea, headache, and generalized aches and pains. In 15 to 20 minutes, there is cessation of spontaneous bleeding. After 30 minutes, the neurotoxic envenoming of the cobra bite begins to improve. In 30 to 60 minutes, hypotension usually improves, but the coagulation abnormalities take a little more time. It may take 3 to 9 hours. Supportive treatment includes one of the major drugs what we use is neostigmine, which has been very, very effective in neurotoxic envenomation. Secondary bacterial infection needs to be covered with antibiotics. Heparin, corticosteroids, fibrinolytics are contraindicated. If compartment syndrome is present, we may have to take a surgical opinion and pancreatectomy needs to be done. Thank you.
Thank you. It was an excellent discussion about snake bite update. And as question and answers, we'll take up after the second session.
Thank you, sir.
Can I request Dr. Arun Kumar to introduce the speaker?